Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. And greetings to everyone. Great that we have a big audience here. I think we are going to touch 100 pretty soon, I think, from the looks of it. We are almost, we are at 90 right now. So I'm very pleased that my good friend, Rukshan Jayawardena, has agreed to be our speaker today and speak about wildlife diversity in Sri Lanka with a, I guess, a focus on leopards. And I can tell you, Rukshan is a mean photographer, having also won, I think, the BBC. He hasn't said this in his bio data, but he won the BBC photographer, wildlife photographer.
No, I haven't won that.
Correct, right, Rukshan? No,
that's not correct. I had an entry that was awarded highly commended.
Special mention. Yes. Well, that's pretty good in itself. So anyway, so let me just give a brief background about Rukshan. Rukshan Jayawardena has a Bachelor of Arts in Anthropology from the University of Maryland in the US, and an MPhil in Archaeology from Cambridge University, and about 14 years of experience in field archaeology. I should mention here that he's also a diver and dives, has done several dives in shipwrecks in and around Sri Lanka, and I don't know where else, so in his field of archaeology. But then I think his real love is wildlife. And so a lifelong interest in wilderness and wildlife has kept him active in the field. And he's a board member of the Environmental Foundation Limited and a past president and committee member of the Wildlife and Nature Protection Society of Sri Lanka, which is in its 126th year of existence. He co-founded For the Leopard Trust and the Wilderness and Protected Areas Foundation, two nonprofit NGOs through which awareness, conservation, and studies of the Sri Lankan leopard have been launched. He also, as I mentioned, seriously pursues his passion for wildlife photography. So without further ado, let me present to you Rukshan. Over to you, Rukshan.
Thank you, Jit. Thank you all. But what I want to talk to you today is kind of an introductory lecture on the biodiversity of Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is a very biodiverse island, and it's really not possible to do even a proper survey of Sri Lanka's biodiversity, just even a mention of the scope of biodiversity found in this island in the space of an hour, so much less in the space of half an hour. I will try to get through as much as I can, but at the end of my talk, in a perhaps a question and answer session, we can cover some of the more some of the aspects that might be of greater interest to you or of specialized interest. Jit, should I share the screen now?
Go ahead and share your screen now.
Yeah. Okay, let me see.
You're able to share your screen, right?
Yeah, I think. Okay,
yeah, there we go.
Yeah. So,
yes.
Are you saying this okay? Do I need to do something else?
Yeah, you just need to go to, I guess, full screen and play rather than,
okay.
So that you're in presentation mode.
Okay,
perfect.
Okay, now?
Yep, great.
Okay. So, when one talks about the biodiversity of this island nation, you can't avoid talking about the elephant, simply because the elephant is the largest land mammal in Asia, at least the Asian elephant, and Sri Lanka is a relatively small confines, is home to between 5,000 to 7,000 elephants. And in South Asia, and all Asia today, Sri Lanka has the highest density of wild elephants to land area. So this, of course, causes various problems for elephants and humans. And there is a serious and kind of growing human-elephant conflict. So the scope of my talk today is not about covering the problems and conservation issues relating to the Sri Lankan elephant, but even if I'm going to focus on the leopard and talk about other wildlife in general, it's the elephant in the room. It's unavoidable mentioning the Sri Lankan elephant. And this is a photograph of, it looks like a greeting from the elephants to us, but it's not exactly that. It is a sign of alarm, of suddenly being surprised. I mean, they surprised me and I surprised them. So in Sri Lanka, tuskers are at a premium, you could say, because we have possibly 5 to 3% of the elephant population are tuskers, or animals that carry what's called ivory. I mean, it's not even a word that is fashionable or good to use today, because it is the very ivory or the ivory tusks that they carry that has made life so miserable for elephant populations worldwide, because of a demand for ivory for various ornaments and various things from time immemorial. But we are now in the 21st century. We are 2 decades on, and that insatiable demand still exists for ivory that comes out of China and some of the other Far Eastern countries. And unfortunately, it is now an underground demand, but the demand is still there. And I think a lot of conservation bodies worldwide are fighting to stop the demand, because what they say is when the buying stops, the killing will stop. So Sri Lanka also has ivory poachers or elephants that are killed for their tusks alone. And so Sri Lanka's tuskers, as a group, their days are numbered, because the natural occurrence of tuskers in the Sri Lankan elephant population is about 7%, which is very low compared to, say, India, for example, where nearly 50% of all males are tuskers. In some areas, all males are tuskers. In other areas, about 50% of the males are tuskers, and 50% are maknas or tuskless males. So order of descent in size, the second largest land mammal in Sri Lanka is the wild buffalo. There are various theories as to how wild buffaloes got to Sri Lanka, because you have to go to northeastern India or Assam to find another viable population. And how did this discontinuous distribution happen? The theory is that the wild buffalo was brought as a traction animal for paddy farming, because it is an animal used even today in some areas in rural Sri Lanka as well as rural India for plowing paddy fields, because they have the type of hooves that will not sink in the mud. And they are also extremely water dependent animals, and so muddy conditions, they actually thrive in muddy conditions. And paddy is a very wet, or it's a crop that is grown inundated. So anyway, the theory that buffaloes came with early Iron Age or paddy farmers who came to Sri Lanka in pre-Christian centuries can be kind of argued through literary sources and other other ways that we get this information. But there is also a very strong case for wild buffaloes having been in Sri Lanka from prehistoric times, that migrated to Sri Lanka from India, and then for some reason in later times, in late prehistoric, early historic times, the population becomes isolated and there's discontinuous distribution between a parent area, probably northeastern India, Burma, and this relic population in the island of Sri Lanka. And genetic studies seems to support the latter. But the most plausible explanation is there are two sources of origin. One, a prehistoric source of migration and colonization of the island by buffaloes, because there were buffaloes in neighboring lands. I mean, not just India, but southern India. And then subsequently, historic period arrivals with settlers from India's paddy farming lands. So that makes this very complicated. Third in size, wild pigs, wild boar. It's still a ubiquitous animal all over Sri Lanka as well as all over India. It's a very important animal, though its conservation priority is really low. It is an animal that turns the land and modifies the landscape, as well as creates opportunities for food for many other animals. And it is also a source of food for predators like leopards in Sri Lanka, of course, and tigers in India. And it's an important animal because it is an omnivore, and it has a very kind of a generalized role in the ecosystem that no other animal can actually fill. Third, to represent the smaller mammals, hare, which is also found countrywide. Now, these two animals I put here because they are on what's called Sri Lanka's negative list. Sri Lanka's negative list is 7 or 8 named animals, mammals, that do not have any protection from Sri Lanka's wildlife laws, which are fairly all-encompassing. So we have something called the Fauna and Flora Protection Ordinance that protects everything other than the named few. And that is the negative list. And the hare, because of its depredation of crops, the wild boar, for the same reason, are on this negative list, unfortunately. But then you have to balance the need of farmers with the needs of conservation. But ecologically, protecting the hare and protecting the wild boar especially is important. So I don't know how countries go forwards balancing this, except that the wild boar is very resilient. So it manages to survive despite all odds. Third, well, in size, this is the other carnivore, the other large carnivore in Sri Lanka, other than the leopard, which is the apex predator, is the Sri Lankan sloth bear. The sloth bear is found discontinuously distributed throughout the Indian peninsula and into the north and the east. But Sri Lankan sloth bear and the Indian sloth bear are slightly different. So this bear has a subspecific name, but I'm not quite sure whether genetic studies confirms that the Sri Lankan sloth bear is indeed a subspecies of the Indian bear. Sri Lankan sloth bears tend to be, on the average, a little smaller, but otherwise there isn't any obvious difference, but subpopulations have variations. Now, the sloth bear is a extremely specialized bear, and it's a specialized carnivore. Firstly, it is it's adapted to an omnivorous diet, though it is truly a carnivore. And its diet is so specialized that the sloth bear has about 50% of its diet is insects, namely termites. So it breaks into termite mounds, especially after rains, and basically vacuums up the termites with a loud sound. And you can hear that, maybe some say about a kilometer away. And I've heard the sound, and it is indeed really loud. It does sound like AI escaping some high pressure unit, but actually the bear blows and sucks and manages to get the termites to come out of the mound and into its mouth and stomach. And for this specific task, the bear has missing front incisors, because if it had incisors, those incisors would get in the way of the termites that get sucked up through like a hose. Representing reptiles, we have two species of crocodiles, just like India has. This is a mugger or a marsh crocodile. And we also have the largest living reptile on Earth, which is the estuarine crocodile, the saltwater crocodile, or most appropriately called the Indo-Pacific crocodile. So the Indo-Pacific crocodile ranges from almost the central Pacific to the east coast of India and right around Sri Lanka. So we are at the western end of the range of the Indo-Pacific crocodile. So we are important range countries, India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, for this crocodile, because it ranges through Indonesia, through Southeast Asia, all the way to Australia, Northern Australia, and into the Pacific. So it has a massive range, and it's a true ocean-going crocodile. It's able to colonize lands, islands, many miles, maybe hundreds of kilometers away from each other by the crocodile's ability to cross open stretches of ocean. So it's truly phenomenal species, and it grows to extreme sizes. And it is also quite dangerous as it gets larger. It's a mammalian predator in its older years, and it might live well over 100 years. And those large crocs pose a threat to humans. But in Sri Lanka, it isn't as much of a problem as it is in Australia. So this is a python representing Sri Lanka's 105 to 110 known snakes. This is, of course, the largest. It's basically the Indian python. But once again, this is a subspecies. So this python molorus is the Indian python. This python molorus timbura, this singular name for this python. The significant difference is that the Sri Lankan python has a pink flush on its head. You can kind of see it here, whereas the Indian python does not, and it has more defined brown, yellow, like a stripe that goes towards the eye. Land monitors, two monitors. One is a land monitor, one is the water monitor. Largest monitor in our entire region is the water monitor, and these are two wrestling for access to females, access to a female who didn't wait to see the end of this, so she took off. So this is a tortoise representing, well, we have one land tortoise, we have two or three freshwater terrapins, unfortunately, I don't have photographs of marine turtles, but we have many species. Five of the seven marine turtles in the world nest on Sri Lankan shores. But recently, with the sinking of the ship, off the Sri Lankan of Colombo Harbour, many, many turtles died due to chemicals leaching out of containers and also little plastic nodules that got into the ocean. So that's quite a sad thing. This is a this is a mouse deer, the smallest species of deer in Sri Lanka and one of the smallest species of deer in the entire world. It's related to musk deer. It's not related to most of the other deer or cervids in the world. It is a specialized feeder. It feeds on, here he was eating fruit. It's not a grazer, it's a browser, but also more fruit eater. And it is a full-grown mouse deer is smaller than a hare. And so the largest is, of course, the sambar, which is also a South Asian, Southeast Asian species. Second largest, very ubiquitous deer, the axis deer. It's called the cheetal in India. And it's just called the spotted deer here. It is an important animal. I'll come to that later. This is the barking deer, or it's also called the chevrotain. And so that makes up four species for us. And we have another species, the hog deer, which is a small population on the brink of extinction. Historically, we had larger numbers, but never so large that they competed with any of the other deer. Monkeys, we have several species. We have two or three subspecies of macaque. We have several subspecies of, we have this one, gray langur, or the Hanuman langur, or Sri Lankan version. We have several purple-faced leaf monkeys, there's quite a radiation. So there are several subspecies, and Sri Lanka could even produce a separate species because of rapid elevation changes, climatic variations that this island possesses in a very small geographic area. So this is a representative of birds in the dry zone. It's an Iora. And that's generally a dry zone, quite a prolific flowering shrub. This is a fishing cat representing the four species of cats we have. The smallest is the rusty spotted cat, the fishing cat, the second largest. Then the second largest is the jungle cat, which is much like a domestic cat, but longer in the legs and with a short tail. The fishing cat is a squatter, a more heavily set animal, and it's larger, and it's about the size of a dog, an average kind of village dog. But it can be even a predator of such dogs. So it's a formidable animal for its size, but it's very appropriately named. It can fish either diving into the water or staying on the bank and fishing, you know, catching fish by striking them with the paws and, you know, hooking them with the claws. So if I was to talk about coastal areas, because Sri Lanka is an island and we have a long coastline for our land area, and these coastal areas contain habitat mosaics that are home to many species who are interdependent. And coastal areas on the island have a high human population density, and national parks with a coastline play a vital role in preserving our coastal biodiversity. So Yala, you may have heard of, Vilpattu, these are the two large lowland parks in Sri Lanka, as well as Kumana and Boondala, smaller parks, all fall into this important category because coastal parks enable us to do is to conserve a gradation of habitat types and biodiversity extending from the coast inland, because Sri Lanka has very close rainforest areas. So in a couple of our coastal parks, the coastal strip of the park is in the arid zone. But if you go into the interior of the park, away from the coast, traveling in a direct line away from the coast, the interior is the wetter part of the dry zone. So if you look at the rainfall patterns, the coast gets half the rain that the interior gets. So likewise, the vegetation changes. So the ecological niches change and the animals that occupy, the diversity changes. So in a relatively small area, you can see a large number of species. Whereas if you have a more uniform park with a more uniform forest type in the interior of the island, but in this island still you don't get that uniformity, but in India you will get uniformity because of the sheer scale of India. And you can find a park in the heart of what was formerly Madhya Pradesh, which would have would be larger, but would have less diversity. So just the way this island has been formed. So that's a coastal scene of a coastal park, Yala, but the tsunami took out those five palmyra trees, palms. So the profile of that landscape has changed and it's a lot more wooded. Other trees took their place. Just to show how lagoons interlink with the open ocean and these kind of salt marsh areas and mangroves all have very specialized ecosystems. And these are, there are ecotones or they form mosaics. So just maybe 2 kilometers from the coast, that's the scene, that's arid zone for Sri Lanka. Very low rainfall and very seasonal. And this is not during the drought, but during the drought, all that grass dries up and almost is non-existent. And many of the trees shed all their leaves. So this is, I think, early in the year when new leaves have come in, but maybe a month after rains. We have many fruit pigeons, many other fruit-eating birds live in our national parks and out in the countryside, and these are three imperial green pigeons or green imperial pigeons, and they are drinking at a waterhole. So even in the arid zone parks, we have a riverine section because many of these parks are watered by at least one river. In the case of Yala, two rivers. In the case of Vilpattu, also two rivers bounding the north and the south. So the riverine forest has a completely different character. It has tall trees. It is quite moist. It harbors very different fauna and flora. And it also acts as a conduit for birds especially and small mammals to travel from the headwaters area, the more mountainous area, down to the coast. So you can find unexpected species in at unexpected times in this riverine strip. It could be only 1 kilometer in extent from the river on either side, but it is a completely different ecosystem to the rest of the park. So migrants from India, from the north, actually further, well, northern India and maybe southern Europe, these are starlings, rosy starlings. And they winter in Sri Lanka in hundreds of thousands every year. And when they come during their non-breeding season. And so they come to Sri Lanka with fairly intense colors. Then they lose that color, they molt, and they regrow their breeding plumage. This is just before leaving again in March or April. They come in to Sri Lanka about October. So hawk eagle representing many of the raptors in these parks. Not once again, these parks provide the home for migrant species. These are European buzzard. I think it's a long-legged buzzard. It's hunting in the spinifex or the coastal littoral kind of spiny grass. And it's hunting an endemic lizard in this particular case. It's called a kangaroo lizard or a fan-throated lizard. And this is a very rare sighting of a Indian tawny eagle. Actually, till I photographed it, nobody had photographed one in Sri Lanka. There were only two, one unconfirmed sight record and another one that they were sure of. But I photographed it thinking it was a booted eagle at first, because when you see a bird for the first time, out of its context, you cannot even, you put it into a box automatically. So I put it into the rarities box. Okay, booted eagle, rare winter migrant or a straggler. But in fact, it was a never before photographed eagle sitting on a branch of one of these ubiquitous palm trees in Yala. So peacocks, Indian national bird, it's a ubiquitous bird in all zones in Sri Lanka. In fact, it's spreading into the wet zone at a rate, and we don't quite understand why, what ecological change has happened. And it is a pest of agricultural crops as well. But people are quite reluctant to kill peacocks in name of crop protection. So I don't know how this thing is going to all end up. This is a short aerial shot of the wet zone forest cover that remains. This is looks vast from this view, but it's really postage stamp in size in relation to the rest of the mountains of Sri Lanka. That's all that's left, which is natural vegetation, and you can see a river running through it, draining. This is Sri Lanka's primary catchment, but very little of its original forest cover remains. So out of the three climatic zones, the wet zone has the highest incidence of endemism. It also has the greatest biodiversity. It's also the most crowded. The southwest quadrant of the island has one out of two people of all Sri Lankans live there. And the forest clearance is large scale from the time of British colonialism for coffee, then followed by tea. And so 90% of the forests were cleared in those days and planted with plantation crops, either coffee first, tea or rubber. And so we kind of effectively lost our catchment, replaced by these plantation crops as catchment, which is highly inefficient compared to what was originally there, highland and lowland rainforest. But our governments have never really factored this in, and they still work on a theoretical basis on what this catchment should be, but it is really not what it was. So 21 biodiversity hotspots in this world. Sri Lanka is one, together with South India, and a hotspot is a circumscribed area that has high endemicity and high diversity, but also very high threat of extinction of the majority of species. So it is good that one's country has a hotspot, but it also means that there is a conservation obligation and some responsibilities to see that the hotspot does not become desertified. This is a endemic from the wet zone, Sri Lankan magpie. It used to be called the blue magpie. Now it's called the Sri Lanka magpie because it is unique to Sri Lanka. Even then they knew it, but the nomenclature was different. They didn't necessarily put the country name next to the endemic, but now that is the trend and the tendency. Related to some Indian magpies as well and European magpies. It's a true magpie. It's in the crow family. It's some like to call it a colorful crow, but that's your perspective. So frogmouths, male and female, slightly different in color. Southern India and Sri Lanka has this frogmouth. It is a very specialized insect feeding nocturnal bird. And it is a restricted range species because it's linked to certain types of habitat and forest cover. And those habitats are diminishing in Sri Lanka. So a white eye, the Sri Lanka's white eye, once again endemic. They say it's the parent bird of all white eyes right through Southeast Asia. It's new genetic finding. So that's fascinating. So the core area for the distribution of white eyes then is Sri Lanka, not some of the Chinese areas or Southeast Asian countries that have even more diversity than we have. We have two species and they may have even three, but all of those species of white eye originate from this one. So this is a pied bushchat, mountain bird, frost on the grass, and the Samba are walking through it, Horton Plains National Park, at about 3,500 meters or 7,000 plus feet. And that's a dwarf bamboo, endemic. Leopards, okay. So the leopard is a keystone species in Sri Lanka. It is the most important a carnivore and most important predator in the island, because this is an island that now no longer has the tiger or the lion. There was a theory that there were lions in Sri Lanka because they did find some bones that they identified as lion bones in addition to tiger bones. But now they say that lion bones are misidentified and they're all tiger. It was a large tiger. It wasn't like an island tiger that you get in Sumatra or Java those two island tigers are small tigers in comparison to mainland tigers, but it is comparable to the Indian tiger or the Bengal tiger rather than even a Southeast Asian tiger. So Sri Lanka has some, in that sense, some oddities, perhaps because India is so close, they migrated across land bridges this island and the Indian mainland was connected. So it is reasonable to assume that the Indian tiger just walked across to the island of Sri Lanka and then ended up kind of marooned on it, as Sri Lanka and India separated during a time of rising sea levels and the inundation of Adams Bridge, or the land bridge between the two. So what happened in Java and Sumatra would be a very different story. Why are there tigers smaller than their own mainland subspecies? So the leopard's value is twofold: as a flagship species for nature tourism conservation and keystone species that's essential to the biological health of the ecosystem. So without the value for tourism, it's hard to conserve the leopard. But without the value for its ecological role, and without fully understanding its ecological role as a keystone species, it's hard to push forward conservation measures or make, scientists are convinced that the Sri Lankan leopard needs to be conserved. But for politicians and other policymakers to be convinced, you need a tourism value to them. So that is there. But the management of this is what's really difficult. Okay, so they are sexually dimorphic. So males are substantially larger than females, 30 to 50% larger. I'll move quickly now because I have more slides to show rather than text boxes. So they're highly intelligent, have individual personality, display many moods. They're highly resourceful, adaptable, and close proximity to humans in many areas leads to some conflicts, but nothing on the scale of India, and not quite uncharacteristic of Sri Lankan leopards are very different to Indian leopards behaviorally. They seem to avoid humans as much as they can. And I think they seem to have actually, through observation, now there is some generational knowledge in leopards to avoid humans and not to make humans part of their prey. Because perhaps in historic times, they had bitter experiences. I find that leopards learn a lot and they pass on that learning to their cubs, and so it gets becomes part of the quote-unquote cultural knowledge of a subpopulation of leopards. So basically, their knowledge, their understanding of us is a lot greater than our understanding of them. And that is the gap we need to bridge. So many moods, many, these adult, mother and cub, a close bond between those two, a small 3-month-old cub, about 2.5-month-old cub. They're curious, they learn to fear humans rather than have a natural fear of them. So if you see cubs when they're very young and you handle them right and let their own curiosity work and get them to come closer to you and investigate and not feel threatened, then they'll relax and they'll grow up into adults that don't fear humans. But that is only a good formula for those that live within protected areas, obviously. So agile, they feel the cold just like us. They'll try to warm up. Main species, prey species in Sri Lanka is the axis deer. So this one's eyeing some. Caught this jackal. The jackal is pretending to die. So the jackals know how to live around leopards and even escape leopards. Even when they're caught and strangulated, they are the greatest actors on earth. And I watched something that I'll never forget. So they need to practice their skills. So jumping between branches, getting it right, boxing, whatever, keeping claws in and making sure that they get the better of each other by just pushing, shoving, hitting, but no scratching or injuries. So young animals have to practice a lot of physical skills so that when they are independent, they become the efficient hunters they do become. So the greatest threats are depletion of prey base, intensive agriculture, land conversion, wire snares, deadfall traps that's declining now, and sometimes poisoning of carcasses of livestock. And Sri Lanka, even as new species are still being discovered, believe it or not, but smaller animals, a raft of others are facing the threat of extinction. So the indirect threats are underfunded departments, underpaid staff, poverty of communities, neighboring protected areas, so that they become a conduit for poachers, and the conflicting use of adjacent lands. The conflicting use of adjacent lands is a thing that policymakers and governments can decide through policy not to do, but now we've many 70 odd years after independence, we still haven't got that right. So the time when wild lands were conserved for their aesthetic value, their recreational value, that is gone, because they now, at least for the past 30, 40 years, they have to have been economically competitive in their own right. And Sri Lanka's parks have not been that. But recently, yes, but it has its own perils. This is what it was like in the past. I mean, it's still like this on certain days. This is because of a leopard sighting. Everybody has lined up on two sides of the road. The leopard is off on a tree. And most of these people can't see the leopard because they're not close enough. So these are these old-fashioned Land Rovers that were used in Sri Lanka tourism not long ago, maybe going back 10 to 15 years ago. But today, there are very different vehicles, Toyota, Hiluxes, modified with greater capacity. But the scene is the same when there is a leopard and there are too many people and there are phone calls or whatever. So those are tourism problems, management problems. But this is the way you can actually watch a leopard. So this is once again from the past, the vehicle. So I kind of try to match the vehicle. This leopard has approached these people, much to their surprise. And so they have put the vehicle slightly off the road, and the road belongs to the leopard. He's right up close and personal in their face. They take all the photos they want. As long as they keep their voices down and their bodies inside the vehicle, the leopard will stay. But if the disturbance level grows, he will go. So that's the adverse impact, the over-visitation. And that needs to be seriously managed. So land set aside for conservation is the best conservation option. 12% of the island, I would say, now was protected by legislation. Recently, they have released a percent, maybe 2 or 3% of this back to agricultural use. So I don't know where we are going with that. But all species are still subject to the fauna and flora protection ordinance. So thank you. Sorry, I overran a bit.
That's fine, Mr. Rukshan. It was fantastic.